respond during the whole COVID-19 climate?
Right, well, you don't ever want tragedy and serious events like this to happen. I do think what you see is they have a real galvanizing effect on teams, on organizations. They bring people together in ways that you cannot imagine. And but for those tragedies and those circumstances, they don't happen. Those teams don't come together and they don't have the resolve that they otherwise would have. Things chug along great, everything's great. You don't tend to hunker down, rely on each other quite as much. There's always a beginning, a middle, and an end to crises, right? The beginning is like a gut punch. It's a sucker punch. It's like comes out of nowhere. You couldn't fully anticipate what it does in the moment. And it sort of blows you away and you're exasperated by, I can't believe this is happening. And then you move into this phase of the middle, but there are beginnings to crisis, there are middles to crisis, and there are ends to crisis. The part that I think is most important is, what do we do in the middle? What do we do in the middle that can help us endure and come out the other side in a better place, potentially in a better place than when we went in? And so there is hope because there will be an end. There always is an end to a crisis.
You know, I just shared that I was on the phone with Jen Fry getting my resume reworked. Actually, with someone before Jen Fry. And she looked at me through the phone as if I were crazy because she said that I wasn't ready. And so trying to jump back in it too soon was my immediate reaction. But again, so thankful for her pushing back so that I could rest, something that we typically don't do in this business, and truly rest my mind and rest my body and replenish myself. So those are my immediate steps.
I reached out to people that were important to me and explained to them where I was and what I was gonna do. I knew there was gonna be chatter, but I didn't want everybody to hear the version that might not be true and that could have been swaying people one way or the other. That was important to me. And then the other thing is that the thing that I didn't realize is how it affected my family, and particularly my young son. And you know, we're sitting watching a football game and on ESPN, and the scroll goes and talked about I had been fired, which I hadn't been, but my son looked at me and said, why didn't you tell me? And this was, he was 13 or 14. And I didn't realize how much of an impact that it would have on him and my daughters. But I look at this now and I can reflect on it. I had 500 and something student athletes, and those were all his brothers and sisters. I mean, he grew up in that, so did my daughters. And so now they're being removed from that, and then they're hearing things about their father that other people are repeating, and you know, true or not true, and they're having to defend our family honor and everything.
Your growth doesn't always come with a paycheck. And so there are many avenues to grow and develop and learn and share and encourage through the use of technology. I would encourage and challenge those that are looking to fill gaps to do so through Zooming, through going to conferences as this one. So Moaa found an opportunity to provide a leadership opportunity through technology.
But the other thing that I've been able to do, and again, being with my family, my kids, going out to a protest and listening to all the different people and what they're feeling, what they're hearing, and what they're sensing. And I think that that's one of the most important things we could bring back to campus when we return, is that we try to understand again where people are, what they're feeling, What do they want? What do these young people want? They want to be heard, and they've grown up differently. They've grown up differently than me and my experience. But I think that, you know, we all owe them that.
So this year's special recognition goes to SME as a result of their work and our partnership on their new logo that we launched a couple of weeks ago. They were very instrumental in helping us hone in on the Moaa brand, and we look forward to continuing our work. Here to accept the award on the behalf of SME is Jason Vogel, Associate Creative Director. Jason.
Thanks, Tim. You know, it's an honor for us at SME as a 30-year-old company that has spent, you know, most of that 30 years working within higher education, college sports, as well as, you know, the entertainment world. To work with Stan and China and the team at Moaa and really, you know, help push the brand forward and get a more in-depth understanding of who Moaa is and the mission really inspired us to, you know, want to work on this project and help the organization move forward. And even more so, you know, in light of what's going on in the world today with current events, it makes, you know, our work and the work that Moaa is doing that much more important. So, you know, from us at SME, we're really happy with the work, really excited about the organization and where you guys are going, as well as, you know, the overall mission. So, you know, thank you guys for allowing us to work on this.
What else would you add as so that we can help position other folks to be in this chair?
Okay, big question. We need like an hour, Desiree, for that one question for us to talk. You know, I would say, first of all, manage your expectations. So I'm going to talk primarily about being an athletic director, advancing in the field or in what I call the enterprise. But as related to what is going on right now socially, all of that applies to managing expectations. Listen, this is a matter of the heart more than anything else. So regulations are one thing, laws are another thing. There are a lot of different things you can do, but when you boil it all down, it's a matter of the heart. And that's a tough situation, a matter of the heart. I mean, people, you can force people to line up with a program and it doesn't change their heart, and eventually it will all fall apart because they don't get it. So I'm going to say that when I was named as athletic director in 1990 at St. Louis University, it was the highest profile female hire in the nation at that point in time in division. Focus on your work. Focus on your work. I'm not saying it's the only thing. I'm just saying we'd be really good at what we do, because of point number two, which is you are disadvantaged and you're going to be disadvantaged. So I'm going to go back to managing expectations, because I am that person. I'm the realist. So there will always be a segment that looks at a female, whether gender minority or an ethnic minority, and looks at that person and goes, they just don't belong in that role as an AD. I don't think they can get this done. I have never focused on them. I can't afford to. There's this large gray mass there that I'm focused on. And those are the people that go, female AD? I've never heard of that. That was 1990. Literally, I've never heard of that. But I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. Let's see what she can do. So focus. Acknowledge that both ethnic minorities and gender minorities in athletics are still disadvantaged, and move forward.
What would you wish you would have known as you were starting your tenure, and what advice do you have for this group in positioning themselves for leadership?
Well, I would just like to echo what both Charlie and Debbie indicated. Obviously, the importance of mentorship can't be discounted. I mean, all of us have benefited from those who crossed that path before us, and it's our responsibility, obviously, to continue to pass that on. And I remember the mentors that I had when I was younger, getting into this business at a small Division II school, not knowing what the future would look like, but knowing that there was a mountain to climb, and that we're going to climb that mountain by myself. And the opportunity to engage with with individuals throughout my career, various stages of my career, are extremely meaningful. And that is really what allowed me the opportunity to sit in a chair at a place like UCLA. So those of us who have spent a lot of time in this business are grateful for the opportunity to give back in that regard. And so I just once again echo what Charlie indicated, that is incredibly important.
A little bit about one of your greatest challenges during your time as athletic directors. And those of you that are on, if you have questions, please make sure and send them in to me via the Zoom group chat, and I'll make sure and filter those.
Well, there have been many, but you know, I think back to, in listening to Debbie, I think back to 1980 when I became the athletic director at UMass Boston, and I was the only minority athletic director in New England. And the first meeting I went to, it was an ECAC, Eastern College Athletic Conference meeting. And as I walked in the room, everybody in the room was white, male, pretty much over 50, and smoking cigars. You could smoke in rooms in those days. And I just sort of looked around the room and said, my goodness, what have I gotten myself into? But the challenge of integrating into that group was really something special for me. And it wasn't being accepted by the group, it was integrating myself into the group that I really wanted to do. And we were able to do that. I think the other big challenge, it happened at the same time. We had no athletic programs at UMass Boston when I was appointed. There was no history, there was no culture, there was no tradition. So it was building from scratch, and that was a huge challenge. It was our first year in the NCAA. In those days, you just had to play in three seasons with men, particularly because they hadn't merged with the AIAW yet. So the challenge of building it from scratch, and we decided we were going to have a women's program at the same time, and putting that together and trying to build a culture to put in place things that would become traditions for our university and our athletic department early on. And then getting the university to understand the importance of athletics.
We're very happy to be touching so many people in our profession. A special thanks to Michael Bazemore, who edit all of our video content, and my vice president, Dr. Edward Scott. A big ups to executive committee member and awards chair, Tim Wise, the superwoman of our organization, Dr. Renee Miles Payne, and the symposium committee for their hard work in putting this together in such a short period of time. And to the NACTA staff, Julie Work and Precious Songbird, you are the backbone to our success. And to our outgoing and incoming Moaa board members, I thank you. And last but not least, our fearless leader and co-founder of this great organization, Executive Director Stan Johnson, who actually could teach a masterclass on how to grow a great grassroots organization and stay relevant in this industry for over 20 years. And lastly, thank you for being here over the last 3 days. And I know you're in and out in different meetings, but you stayed with us the entire time. So thank you for believing in this organization. Over 750 members strong and growing. What an honor to be in this position to experience this growth. Remember to support our annual giving campaign in the fall. Your supporting gifts will enable us to continue providing our annual symposium, scholarships, professional development grants, and various other programs Moaa has established. These developmental opportunities and experiences for our membership and others will enhance their individual careers both in and out of athletics. If you know anyone who wants to join Moaa, please make sure they reach out to Pac-12 Cheryl Long. She's our membership chair. So make sure you reach out to her because we want everyone to be a part of this wonderful growth. Well, the 2020 symposium is officially in the books. We're hoping to see you in person at next year's symposium at the World Center Marriott in Orlando, Florida on June the 13th and the 14th in 2021. James Baldwin said, "Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it's faced." Let's continue to support those who want to be a part of that change and those who are willing to talk about those uncomfortable issues that are currently happening in the world. So I want you to be safe, stay healthy, keep washing those hands and practice social distancing. Have a wonderful day, everyone. Take care. Thank you.